What's up, guys? How y'all doing? I'm Muggsy, upcoming hip-hop artist from Sydney, Australia, of the land down under. And right now, I'm just going to talk a little bit about myself for 50 Shades of Purple, anti-bullying. You know, obviously, a lot of people don't know, but when I was an early teenager, I used to get, you know, punked and bullied a lot in my upbringing of, you know, high school and that kind of thing. So, you know, it's kind of just going to be like a little origin story of how, you know, I rose above it and got into, you know, the culture of hip hop and, you know, escalated and changed my life through that. So let me take you way, way back, kind of like, you know, Hugh Jackman Wolverine style, because he's from Australia here as well. So, yeah, like when I was 14 and stuff, you know, I think it was like year 7, year 8 of high school, I was kind of like, you know, the shy kid that didn't really have much social skills and like confidence and that kind of thing. And I suppose, you know, they always say that high school is the place where, you know, you find yourself, like you're growing up into the man you want to become or the woman you want to become, you know, and it's the first couple of steps. So it's kind of a developing learning curve, but when you're not that so-called Mr. Popularity kind of thing, it becomes like, you know, very, very hard for the antisocial types. So yeah, I suppose I was a sore thumb standing out, and you know, I used to get punked and bullied a lot, which, you know, later caused me to, you know, suffer from depression and, you know, sink into that, you know, that dark hole of, you know, angry thoughts. And at that age of 14, and obviously, you know, teenagers can relate to it, you kind of can't think into the future of, this is just a learning curve, this is just a phase, it's all going to pass when we all grow up. We kind of think in the now, like, why is the world hating on me? What have I done wrong? You know, it'd be better if the world doesn't need me anymore and that kind of thing. And, you know, like, I can understand, because, you know, I went through that as well. And having those depressive thoughts, like, led me to a whole nother level of, you know, suicidal. And, you know, my parents and my family were so worried about me around that time. They're like, we don't want to lose our son. But, you know, got psychologists and, you know, therapists and all that kind of stuff. Nothing worked, because I was still each and every day having to go to this place that just hated me and just, you know, was going to torment me and that kind of thing. And, you know, they're worried, like, should we take him out of the school, you know, or what is going to happen in another school? And, you know, it becomes difficult, because, like, it's just, we, you know, I don't know the origin of where, you know, people judge each other and, like, you know, just straight off the bat and not give them a chance. But, like, to cut a long story short, you know, having that anger and that sadness and stuff at the age of 14 in, like, the early 2000s, you know, MTV, BET, you know, VH1 and, like, everything around that time was promoting the hell out of hip-hop. And I remember just watching it as a teenager, being like, you know, being a white boy myself and just seeing Eminem and D12 and, you know, 50 Cent and G-Unit and being like, I want to be like those guys. I want to be like those urban, gritty, like, you know, just don't give a crap about, like, what people think of them kind of thing. Just have that attitude in their soul and like their persona. And, you know, like, I attracted myself to that. And I always say that, you know, 90s was the golden era of hip hop, but I still reckon that the early 2000s was the best marketing platform of hip hop, you know? So obviously, you know, I related a lot to Eminem, because, you know, the Marshall Mathers LP, oh man, like, yeah, obviously he had the, you know, the Slim Shady, the Marshall Mathers, the Eminem Show, but I still feel the Marshall Mathers LP was the number one that attracted me. You know, songs like The Way I Am, or, you know, like, when like, fast forward, obviously, when 8 Mile came out, Lose Yourself, and just his wordplay and his delivery and his anger and just reaching out, saying, like, you know, just because I'm different doesn't mean, like, I gotta be judged, sort of thing. And, you know, I thought, man, why do I want to be, you know, the shy kid? You know, why do I want to be picked on and bullied and that kind of thing? You know, I don't want to put my family through this. I don't want to put myself through this, you know. Like, I hardly have any friends. My grades were failing, and, you know, the you know, people or the teachers around me were always focused, like, you got to get, you know, your HSC, because if you don't, you won't get a job after school, you'll be a nobody, and all this kind of stuff. And it was that fear of, wow, I don't have, you know, socially, you know, skills, like, of the people around me, to a friend to, like, put their hand out and be like, it's going to be all right, man. Or the teachers, you know, like, I'm not, like, you know, disrespecting teachers or nothing, but, like, the teachers at my school were pretty bad. Like, they were just, like, you know, if I could go back in time and explain it more better to you, they were kind of like the types which were, like, you know, if you weren't so-called Mr. Popularity and you were kind of like the shy kid, the loner sort of thing, it was just like, well, you know, like, it's our job to stand by you. But I didn't see none of that in my school. It was a pretty heavy kind of school. So who did I have to turn to, you know? Like, obviously, you know, like, everyone around me was just a no-go. So when I started attracting myself to, obviously, the hip-hop culture and Eminem, you know, like, I started dropping down rhymes and that kind of thing. But I knew if I wanted to progress as an artist, I would have to write full-pledged songs, like, bar for bar, lyric for lyric, you know, choruses, verses for, you know. And I remember doing a first demo halfway through high school, and yeah, like, it was like a 3 or 4 track demo, and I was, like, you know, trying to, like, hand it around, or, you know, trying to hand it around to my, you know, like, local groups who I knew who would either take the time to listen to it, or even just local hip-hop communities. And, you know, at first, a lot were like, yo, like, who's Muggsy? Like, give us a good reason why we should, you know, we should roll with you, kind of thing, because we don't know who you are. And it was kind of like, man, now I'm trying hip-hop and no one's taking the time to listen to my music. Like, you know, like what's going on here, you know? I just thought, man, all right, so can't do hip-hop now because no one's listening and that. But so I sat back and I just started listening to more artists and developing more of the culture, like, you know, the 70s, where it came from, you know, just the origins and, you know, the Boogie Down Bronx and that kind of thing. And I started progressing at my craft. And I remember, you know, I came across this group called MAD, Musicians Making a Difference. Shout out to them. And yeah, like, I remember walking past their office, and they had all these hip-hop posters in the wall of their office. You know, one was, like, a rapper, one was a breakdancer, and one was, like, a DJ. And I thought it was an indie record label at first. Then I remember walking in there and talking to Emma and Dom, and I was like, yo, like, you know, I'm Muggsy, I'm in high school, you know, I'm an upcoming hip-hop artist, can you take my demo? And they're like, yeah, well, you know, we'll definitely listen to it, but we're not an indie record label. We're a youth organization that, you know, that does a lot of programs to help, you know, teenagers, whether they're, you know, drug abuse, homeless, depression, like, because I was going through depression and suicidal. And we teach a lot of hip-hop-based courses and stuff, whether it be learning how to, you know, record in a studio, or, you know, learn how to dance, or, you know, learn how to perform in front of a crowd. So I got on board with them, and I did, like, I think one of their courses called Sound Foundations, which was, like, better at the mic, or better in the studio and on stage, and that was, like, about 6 months of that. And it was just this real family welcoming group, and they, you know, they taught me, like, sort of skills of, you know, we're all different in this world, and you know, if you're kind of just judging someone straight off the bat, like, you know, who gives you the right, you know, like, you don't know what that person's been through. They could be the best person in the world, and, you know, you might not even recognize that because you're judging them straight off the bat, you know. So obviously, you know, I started growing up more and like, releasing content, but I feel that having that, those, you know, I guess, angels on my shoulder, like, you know, Eminem and, you know, 50 Cent, Tupac and stuff, it was kind of like that voice to, you know, give me a voice to fight back and change myself from that shy kid into a hip hop kiddo, you know, and be like, man, you know, I don't want to be sad anymore. I don't want to be depressed. I don't want to put my family through this. You know, I want to change myself and, you know, just be the best I can be, whether it be in hip hop or just in society in general. And, so, you know, throughout from 14 to like leaving high school, I was just incorporating myself, you know, the way like I moved, like from my clothes to, you know, my talk to my swag, you know, and I just slowly developed into this, you know, kid that no one recognized, to this, just this hip hop kiddo. And it's crazy because now, a lot of people know me as the hip hop kiddo around my neighborhood. And, I guess those guys kind of saved me, you know, like, because if I never found hip hop, I don't know where I'd be today. I don't even know if, like, I'd be a different person, or even if I'd be alive today if I would have taken it, you know. And I don't want to sound, you know, very moody and very, you know, down in the dumps, but, like, that's just the facts. And, you know, so it's crazy because all those years ago with Mad, they saw what I was doing in my own career, and they're like, yo, Muggsy, do you want to be a youth instructor and help the next teenagers come in? And, you know, how could I say no to that? Like, so I sort of do youth work programs with them, and yeah, like, it's crazy because, you know, I get the same teenagers coming in, and, you know, they're so upset and they're so angry at the world, like, knowing, you know, they just come in and be like, oh, you know, this person's hating on me, or, you know, like, my parents aren't understanding me, and this kind of thing. And it's kind of like looking into a mirror, because I was like, yo, I know the exact same feeling you're going through, little man, like, you know. And it's just, you, to all these people watching this anti-bullying, like, hopefully this is a motivational video for you, is you just have to find your inner passion or your inner, whatever you want to be in life, to incorporate you, and to also make yourself change. Like, you just can't start with nothing saying, I want to change. You have to find something, you know, to make you want to change. And the thing is, I realize a lot of creativity is a main power source to get out of that dark hole. Like, it's just insane, whether it be acting, music, even the likes of painting and drawing. It's just, that's the power of creative arts, of just, you know, bringing people out of that you know, that negative spiral of a world. Like, you know, life's tough, but, you know, you just got to keep pushing, because we only get one shot this life. And, you know, I feel that because of social media, and, you know, like, people always want to be, you know, like, the best of the best now. Like, you know, he's got this car, I want that. Or, you know, she's got, you know, this good looking, I want to be like that. We're currently kind of living in, like, a narcissistic generation now from this social media. But I feel that if, you know, all I can say is just be yourself, you know. Like, if you are nitpicking and kind of just like, just because this person doesn't have this, or, you know, I want to be like that, or I should deserve that, with no remorse and, like, no work ethic, and just me, I feel like, look, it's down to the nitty gritty. You're just a sheep. You're not a wolf. You're just a sheep. Like, I'm not sounding like, you know, like an ass or nothing about it, but I just feel that, you know, it's just such a small mind of thinking, because, you know, we're all equal in this world. And I feel that, you know, because I went through the lower end of the stick, I've got this mindset now where, like, whoever comes up to me, I give them the time of day. I don't judge them straight off the bat, like, just because they're not my, you know, my cup of tea. Well, I don't drink tea, it's my cup of coffee, you know. So, yeah, like, you know, from a shy kid till now, I've achieved incredible things in my career. You know, I've received radio play, interviews, man, fan bases and stuff worldwide. I've achieved, I think my biggest three, and three is my lucky number, like, would have to be, I remember, you know, 2012, I performed at this, you know, talent competition called Urban Star, and performed my track Keep On Rapping, and there was three judges on the night, And that one of the judges was a guy called Marcus Pinnell. Shout out to him and rest in peace to my man. You know, he used to work for Def Jam. And to anyone who knows about Def Jam, they know that it's one of the biggest, you know, record labels in, you know, hip-hop. It signed the likes of Jay-Z and you know, Rihanna and stuff. And he had a house down here in Australia, and he was looking for just, like, new talent to check out. And I remember when I saw his name on the bill, I just thought, I have to give him my all. Like, I have to put my all into this effort because, you know, like Eminem said, you only have one shot. And I went up on the night, and I think there's YouTube footage of it, so, like, I don't know, you guys check it out. And two of the judges, I remember, scored me with a zero, which didn't make sense to me, but yeah, I was more shocking. And I remember Marcus, and he did the whole Simon Cowell thing, you know, where he keeps you waiting and you're thinking, he's gonna score me with a zero, like someone that's in his position in the industry. Yeah, if two of them are scoring me with a zero, then, you know, I'm out. Like, should I just walk off the stage right now? But I remember he gave me a 10 out of 10, and the crowd went wild. And I just thought, man, like, knowing that someone in his position has given me that, you know, that score, it was just mind-blowing to just say to myself, you know, I should continue this. I should continue making music and help, you know, like helping people through Mad and you know, just inspiring people with blog videos and that kind of thing. So that was my number one. My number two would obviously be in the Reverb Nation charts. I'll never think to this day, because a lot of people, when they see everything I've done for myself and my career, they instantly refer, thinking I either have a manager, a street team, or a label behind me. And to be perfectly honest, I don't. It's just me, Muggsy, by myself. It's just sleepless nights, a whole ton of coffee, and just the hustle and drive to make this my reality. And yeah, in the Reverb Nation charts, I got number one in the hip hop charts for the Central Coast. It's about an hour and a half north of the Sydney CBD. So Central Coast is like a coastal kind of like area, which is sort of like semi-big. I got number one in that. Number one in Sydney, which was insane, because like Sydney is like, I think, like the biggest city in Australia. And number one in New South Wales, a state in Australia, which was just my state, New South Wales. And it was just, words are just like, whoa, like, you know, just number one in that. And I think I'm number five in all of Australia, so I'm trying to hit that number one position at the moment. But you know, it's just gonna take some time and just keep doing what I'm doing. So that was my number two. And my number three, I should say, is to this day, it still gives me butterflies and it still gives me chills, because I remember in 2016, I got my music Can't Stop Us featuring my man Pablo. It's on my second album, Understand Me. You know, I got it played on a station, I think, in California called LAF Underground Radio. And they were, you know, putting my stuff in rotation and you know, tweeting it non-stop and you know, just tagging big corporate names or big celebrity names in it. You know, like, it would just be like, one week they'd be like, yo, check out this other artist, hashtag 50 Cent, or, you know, check out this artist, hashtag Drake, or something like that. You know, just these big names to try and, you know, just that one little bit of hope to say, come on guys, like listen to it. And obviously, you know, those guys are in way bigger positions, and, you know, maybe they might listen to it, or maybe they might not have, you know, the time of day, because they're so work drive busy, you know what I'm saying? So I remember when it came to me, and it was like, Muggsy, Can't Stop Us, hashtag LAF Underground Radio, hashtag LeBron James, the LeBron James. And I'm a huge NBA supporter, and I remember, you know, the next morning I woke up, and each day when I wake up, I get my morning coffee, I sign into Facebook, I sign into emails just to check everything that's, you know, got myself on. And it said, Twitter retweeted, LeBron James tweeted to your track. And at first I thought, it's got to be a fan profile, this can't be legit, you know, like, there's been a lot of fan profiles out there. And I remember going onto his Twitter, and it was the legit, like, millions of followers, the legit LeBron James. And he tweeted to my track saying, dope track, keep pushing for your dreams and goals, man. And it was, see, I got just chills right now thinking about it. Like, you know, someone that in his caliber taking the time to listen to my track Can't Stop Us, knowing that I'm an underground artist and just from a small coastal town here in Australia. That's the power of just my hustle and drive to like try and make this a living, you know. So I kind of look back and think, man, to all these kids that, or these teenagers, or just whoever's getting bullied and, you know, just feel like they're a nobody, or just feel like, you know, I can't go on in this life because what's life, you know, doing for me? Look, man, like all I say is we only get one shot at life, and you know, obviously, hopefully this vlog video has, you know, given you like a chin up and like a rise up, because you know, I feel I had nothing as well. Like when I was younger, obviously I explained at the first of this video, had nobody to turn to, and I was on the verge of suicidal, like putting my family through that. And you know, like coming from that to, you know, the developing stepping stones with like my angels on my shoulder, like my M&Ms and that kind of thing, and now to the point in my career where someone as big as LeBron James is supporting my music, or like taking the time and knowing that I'm number one in my state of my own country. It's just words can't even explain, and that's how much I've changed my life into this culture of hip hop. And I thank hip hop day in and day out. Like I wake up hip hop, I go to sleep hip hop, I dream about hip hop because I am hip hop, and I feel like that's what saved my life. And all I can say to anyone that's getting, you know, bullied or just, you know, feel like they have no hope in life, just find your inner passion or your inner whatever you want to do in life. And you know, even if you don't get the same mutual respect back, like even if these, you know, you try and put your hand out for someone and they don't put their hand out back for you, just know at the end of the day that you became the better person. Like you weren't the sheep, you were the wolf, you know, like just, or like maybe you just don't have the most flashiest look, or you know, or you don't have the most money, or you don't have the most friends or something. Just know that, you know, like be yourself and embrace yourself. That's a good term, embrace yourself. See, through me, I embrace it through hip-hop, and you know, look at me now, I'm still working hard. And obviously a lot of people look at my career and some even become surprised because they're just like, man, like you're an inspiration for how much stuff you've worked on, and you know, with little to nothing. So if I can do it, guys, you can do it. And just know that I've been through it as well, and whoever's down, I've got your back, you know. So obviously hopefully this has helped the next person in need, but just find your inner star. Like I said, and understand me, we're all fighting to become our inner star. So hopefully this helped out everyone, and shout out to 50 Shades of Purple, not 50 Shades of Grey or 50 Shades of Black, 50 Shades of Purple anti-bullying. Keep supporting their movement because they're doing incredible things for just anyone who's going through this, and hopefully I could help. Shout out from Muggsy here in the land down under. I'm out. Peace.